Good afternoon. Once again, thank you and welcome to a Team Support product webinar. As you see our smiling faces on there as usual, for any of you who have participated in these before, we have, that's my smiling face up above. I'm Robert Johnson, and below me is Eric Harrington. And again, for those of you who haven't done these with us before, what we're going to do is spend a little bit of time going through the product and some new features we have in Team Support. And then we'll go through and do a Q&A session at the end and try to go through a bunch of questions about the product and answers. And we'll answer what we can, and we'll defer to later for those that we can't. And we'll talk about that a little bit as we get further along. As I'm sure most of you noticed, we have done a great deal of updates to the product over the weekend, a bunch of ones that we're really excited about, and we'll be talking about as many of those as we can. One thing I didn't do was introduce Eric and just say hello, Eric. So I'll let you say hello to our audience here, Eric.
Thanks, Robert. Hello, everybody. Glad to be doing this again. Seems like yesterday, but that means we're making good progress. So we appreciate your time joining us today.
Yeah, it was almost yesterday. I think we did our last webinar a little over a month ago. So we've been, as you can well imagine, our development team here and support team and DevOps team have been very, very busy the past, well, for the past several years, but certainly the past 6 weeks or so. So as I said, we're pretty excited about some things we released in the product over the weekend, and going to spend the next 45 minutes to an hour talking about these and getting you educated on what they can do. So the things we're going to talk about today are the product lines feature, customer insights, another brand new feature, a new screen recorder, which is not actually a new feature, but a way we are redoing something we've had in the application for quite a while. Video recording is brand new, and I'm going to try to do on the webinar both screen recording and video recording live in the webinar, and I'm crossing my fingers. I did some tests. I think they'll work, but we'll see. There might be some crossover between the good webinar software and our software, and we'll hope it all works. And also, of course, the new ticket page. We've been talking about this for a while. We've had it in limited beta and limited release with a handful of customers in internal use, and we've elected to open it up to public beta here over the weekend as well. And again, we'll talk about more what public beta means and how you can help us test that feature as well. So without further ado, we'll jump right into it. Product lines. Product lines is a feature that we're actually excited about, and it opens up a lot of different opportunities for us as well. In broad strokes, what product lines allows us to do is group various products we have in Team Support under an umbrella, so to speak. And the benefit for that really, it came from some of our larger customers who were running multiple divisions of a company all under one Team Support system. We have some companies that use multiple divisions in Team Support that run separate instances of Team Support across multiple divisions. And while that works, it does cause problems as far as reporting and trying to roll up reporting. And also, if there are cases where a ticket crosses a product line, so to speak, there really wasn't a good way to do that. So we came up with the idea of product lines, again, in conjunction with some of our larger customers. And the idea really is to allow separation of products, grouping of products together, and then separation of those products. So you can run multiple either product groups or product even divisions with a larger company all in one Team Support instance. So we allow product grouping, but we also, one of the nice things there is we allow security rights. And I'll dive into that in a little more detail here in a second. But you can actually set the system up so that a person in a given division who only has access to a single product line really only thinks Team Support is set up for them. They don't see the other products in the system. They don't see the other tickets. And from a security standpoint, but also just from a standpoint of having them see all of the information they need to see and access in Team Support, we have all that ability in the system. We also have now the ability to brand emails separately going out. So again, in a case where there's multiple divisions or multiple really distinct products being supported by a single company in a single instance of Team Support, the emails that go out can be branded by that company or by that product. And have separate messaging depending on which product that email or that ticket is associated to. So without further ado, let me jump into our Team Support demo account here. This is our Bits and Bytes account, which is our kind of demo company that we use, and show you product lines. So we'll go down here to products, and you'll notice now we have a new icon up here, product lines. We've always had products, product versions, and all. But now we have product lines. So under products, I have a list of all the various products in this particular instance of Team Support. If I go to product lines, we'll see that we have now four distinct product lines. And I used the term umbrella earlier to talk about really what a product line is. And of course, we even have that icon here that we're using. And it really does define fairly well what a product line is. It's a way to organize existing products and put them under one umbrella. So in this case, I'm going to go ahead and click on our database products, which is one umbrella product we have. And we'll see a consolidation of all of the open tickets and closed tickets, and of course our recent ticket history over here as well, for this product line. So this would be all the open tickets and all the closed tickets for all of the products under this product line. So in this case, we have all of our database products, and you'll see we only have two in this case, but we have DBWizard and Oracle, which are products under this product line. So if we were to click on one of these, we'll pull up the standard product screen, which we've always had. But the one difference here is the product line. Under product info, you'll see the product line is database products. So again, if we go up here to the database product line, you'll see that we have the consolidation of all of the tickets for this product, for all the products under this product line. We can also add custom fields down here. We can add as many as we can in most places in Team Support. We can add as many custom fields at the product line level as we need. And then we go to the actual product. We'll see the only real difference in the product is you see the product line right here. To associate a product with a product line or change one, very simple, simply go up here on the product screen, hit edit, and come down here to the product line and then select whatever product line this particular product is a part of. Each product can only be a part of one product line, of course, but a product line can have obviously as many products as you want in that product line. So the two things, this is great for grouping products, but the two things that really make this unique are the user rights and, of course, then the email. So if we go to users here, I'm going to select, I'll go ahead and select me here. That's my smiling face there, a candid picture of me. And if we scroll down under user information and rights, now I'm an admin in this account, so I can do this. If you're not an admin, obviously you couldn't change the user rights for a given user, but I can in this case. So for a long time, we've had the ability under the ticket rights field here to change what a given user can see. Most users in Team Support are set up to see all tickets. They can see everything in the system. But again, for a long time, we've had the ability to limit that. So a given user can only see their assigned tickets, their tickets that are assigned to them, and also their tickets in their group. So for example, if they were in the Tier 1 support group, they would only be able to see tickets associated to them or assigned to them and tickets that are in the Tier 1 support group, or only tickets that are assigned to a or associated with a specific customer or customers, plural. So if you had a support organization where your team was assigned to individual customers, you could set up a group of customers and have users only see those customers. So these are nothing new. We've had these in the system for a while, but I figured since we're talking about user rights, it'd be a good time to go back and take a look at what user rights we've had in the system for a while. The new part of this, however, is product lines. So generally, you can set somebody up to see all product lines or only specific product lines. So in this case, we can set this up, this user, which is me, to see database products and what was my one I had there? What was my other product I had? Apollo. There we go. So now I can see, I'm not going to save this because otherwise it'll mess my demo up entirely, but if I save this, then this user, me, would only be able to see tickets that are associated with a product that is under database products or under Apollo. And that applies to everything in the system. It applies to reporting, it applies to the dashboard, it applies to search, it applies to everything. So once we've restricted this user to seeing these product lines, they will only see tickets under those product lines or tickets that are unassigned, tickets that are not associated to a particular product. So this is a very powerful user right system for us. It allows you to put, in fact, we've got some customers that have individual divisions running on the system but may have a common support group that triages early stage tickets, and they're actually a part of multiple divisions or multiple product lines in our system, so they can assign, they can take an inbound ticket and then assign it to the correct product, and off they go. So user rights is a big part of what we can do in product lines, and a big really reason for the product line feature was added to the system as well. The other neat, well, let me show you one more thing here. In admin, the way you turn this off, excuse me, the way you turn it on, because actually it's defaulted off to everybody in the system right now, is right here, use product lines. So to turn product lines on, simply go to admin, my company, account settings, and change this setting. If it's false in your system right now, change it to true, refresh your browser, and you will see those product lines option now in the product section. The other neat thing we can do in product lines, which I think we'll have a lot of support for, is different email templates. So if you go to admin and email, just as a refresher, and you'll see a lot of options for email, and then scroll down. These are our alternate email templates right here, alternate email, inbound alternate emails, which is actually a really neat feature we have in the system. If you come down to the email template section, this is where you can customize and make every email that comes out of your team support system very unique to your settings. So in this case, I'm going to come down here and go to new ticket confirmation. So this is the email that goes out when a ticket is submitted into team support. It's basically the thank you email that goes out and says thanks for submitting a ticket. It has your branding on it, has more information. A lot of cases has a point to the knowledge base, so a customer can get self-service. And until now, no matter what product a ticket was associated to, everyone got the same email. But now we can do it, we can make it separate. So notice this new box right here. So the new ticket confirmation, without any product or product line associated to this particular email, or this particular ticket, excuse me, you will get the generic message down here. However, if you say for the database product line, you notice that we've actually changed this now. So it says, thanks for contacting us about our database product. That's a very, very simple way of customizing that email. We can make it much more custom. We can do graphics around it. We can do really anything you want to and customize this email template to be whatever you want it to be. A lot of our customers are supporting completely different products within one team support instance. And this, under product lines, allows them to brand those emails and make those emails distinct to that product line and keep that divisional or product grouping identity separate. So, very powerful feature. We're very excited about it. We're already seeing a lot of early adoption with it with some of our early testers on the system, and looking forward to your feedback on that as well. Now, Eric, did I cover everything on product lines?
You did, and thank you for showing where the setting was, because we had a few questions come up about why they couldn't see product lines in their interface. So that's all sorted out. So thanks for bringing that up.
Sure. Thanks, Eric. The one thing I will mention, it's obvious, but the product lines feature is only available in our enterprise version. The support desk version does not feature the products and inventory section in the GUI. So if you're looking at your system and wondering where the product section is on the left-hand side, that's probably because you're running our support desk version. If you're interested, of course, in bumping up to enterprise, just let us know, and that's an easy change for us to make. Alrighty, so that's product lines. Customer insights, another new feature we're pretty excited about. One of the things that we feel is a big difference of team support, certainly versus our competitors, is that we provide you with the opportunity to have a great deal of information about your customers within team support. We've always had Office of the Customers and the contacts, and we've had the ability of tracking notes and files and custom fields and a lot of data about your customers in the system. But until now, it's really always been data that you have entered into the system or that has been synced with a CRM system such as Salesforce, because of course we've got a great integration with Salesforce and other CRM systems to pull that data across. But what Customer Insights allows us to do is we're integrating with publicly accessible data sources. Mostly LinkedIn, but we will occasionally pull data from Facebook and Twitter, to get public profile images and company descriptions and put those into your team support account. So we really think it allows you a better and more personal understanding of your customers, gives your support agents much more reference information about the customers. It also provides images, if we can find them, for your customers. And again, for a more personal interaction and better understanding of your customers. One very important thing to understand in this is it is inbound only. We are pulling information from publicly accessible data sources. We're not opening up your personal LinkedIn account to pull information across. This is only information that your customers have elected through their use of social media to effectively make accessible to everybody, and we're simply mining that information. No data from your team support account is going out to anyone else. We had one concern about that early on when we turned Customer Insights on, and that's not the case at all. Nothing ever goes out of your team support account. This is all inbound and all information that we're gleaning from publicly accessible data sources. So what does this look like? Well, if you go to our customer section, you'll see it almost immediately. In fact, I've got a search right here for team support, because that's the easiest data for us to pull. So I'm in the customer section, I've searched on team support, and you'll see a couple things very quickly. You'll see logo information for companies, if we can find it, and you'll also see pictures for individuals, if we can find them as well. So if we go to IBM, for example, we'll see the logo for IBM. If we click on the company name, we'll actually see a great deal of information that we can provide, we can pull about this company right here. So IBM, we all know IBM, Big Blue, but we get their logo and we also get a fair amount of information about that particular company. So again, for your support agents, if they're not familiar with a customer particularly, obviously your sales team would be, but your support team may or may not be, they can very quickly get a much better understanding of the company all within the team support interface, all automatically generated from team support. The same thing if we're searching on, let's search on team support, so we know the data's there. So team support, we'll see again the logo here, and I'm going to pick on Eric. It is a horrid picture of Eric, and I apologize for this, Eric, but I can click on Eric's name, and I see a very bad picture, sorry Eric, very bad picture of Eric that we pulled off social media someplace. But the other neat thing we can do is we're automatically populating the LinkedIn profile right here. So let's say I get a ticket from Eric. I've learned more about the company. I know about team support now. Let's learn more about Eric. I can click on the LinkedIn profile. That is automatically generated. That's a better picture. If you like that picture. So that's, again, the link is automatically generated. We can click on it. We can find more information about Eric and get more context about who he is and who the company that he works for is and understand that, so we can provide better support and more contextual support as well. A couple things to note on Customer Insights. As I said earlier, we don't send any data out. You won't necessarily see all this data populated in your system. You probably will start seeing some information popping up in your system over the next couple of weeks. We are mining the data over time. We did not go and pull data on several millions upon millions of customers and contacts we have in the system. That wasn't feasible. So what we've done is we're prioritizing companies and contacts which are changed. So if we go to IBM here, for example, on the company information, the way we're pulling it is from the website. So we need to have website information to be able to pull that data on a company. So if you go to a company and click on edit and come down here and edit that URL in that company, in this case, obviously, IBM.com, that will, within generally the next 24 hours, potentially faster, that will pull that information. It goes into a queue, and as soon as we get to it, that'll queue into the system and update it. So the way our algorithm is working is we're updating changed or new companies or contacts, and then we're updating, after that, we're updating kind of everybody else in the system. So recently changed or updated companies or contacts will get that information prioritized. We do have to have a website for that. If that website information is not being pulled over automatically from a CRM synchronization or an import, go ahead and type that in there, and then we'll sequence that to pull that data across for you automatically. With individuals, same thing. We've got their email address, so that's fine. We should get that data, but we're only going to get that data if something has changed or if that record is new. Just the way we're prioritizing the data being pulled across. Anything, Eric, you want to add in that I've forgotten about?
Eric? Sorry, I was on mute. No, thanks for that picture, Bill. I appreciate it. And everybody, please friend me on LinkedIn.
Now we know where you are on LinkedIn. You've got a better, much better picture on LinkedIn, too. So the picture is somehow, we don't always know where we're getting the data from. We do prioritize, because we're primarily, obviously, a business-to-business solution, we do prioritize getting data from LinkedIn. If we can't get it from LinkedIn, we will pull it from another data source. But as much as possible, we're trying to pull the data directly from LinkedIn. So, again, another new feature we're excited about. Just got turned on, so it's going to take a little while to populate, and certainly looking forward to any feedback that you have on that as well. Alrighty, new screen recorder. For a number of years now, we've had the ability in Team Support to record, both for your agents to record screens to give your customers, but also for your customers to record those screens and submit them as part of a ticket to you as well. Love that feature, really exciting feature, and we were a little upset that our vendor that actually provides that service to us elected to get out of this space as of June 30th, actually. And because this feature was really one of our more popular features in the system, and a lot of our customers are using it and creating a lot of screen recordings, we didn't like the fact that it was going away, and we frankly wrote our own. We worked the last several months writing our own implementation of this, and again, it's not a new feature in Team Support. It is pretty much the same functionality we've had in the system before, which with a few tweaks. But it is an entirely new code base, integrated very tightly into Team Support now. I know we've had some issues with screen recordings in the past, not always being available, and some other issues, and that we think those are addressed now. The only issue we have, and this is frankly nothing we can get around at this point in time due to technology, is that it is a Java-based implementation. For various technical reasons, Java is going away. And we don't know how long Java has. We know that certain browsers, particularly Chrome, are aggressively trying to get rid of Java. I believe in, I think around the September timeframe, Google has said that Chrome will no longer support the Java implementations. It's going to affect us and some other companies as well. It does appear that other browsers are going to continue using Java for a while. So if Java is going away, why are we still using Java? Well, to put it quite bluntly, there is no other way to do the screen recording like we've done it in this system. You can record a browser window through some other technologies, but you can't get to the desktop, and that's just a issue of how a web browser interfaces with the desktop. And in fact, that's one of the reasons, security reasons, why Google is getting rid of Java. So not to get too into the weeds on technical issues, but what that basically means is Java is going to go away. It's not away. It's not going away yet. Keep on using screen recording, and we are actually working on a replacement even for the Java, but the technology to do that has not yet evolved in the web browser. So a lot of moving parts right now, but at the moment, screen recording still works and works quite nicely. So how does it work? Why does it look differently? Well, let's do a new ticket here, and so it, again, looks very similar. There's a red button that says screen recording, record screen. I'm going to warn you that this, I think it'll work in a GoToMeeting session or GoToWebinar session. We'll find out here in a second. You press the button, and let's see what happens. That screen, ignore that screen, that's a debug screen. Cross my fingers. There we go. All right. I knew it was going to work. I just didn't know if it was going to work 100% with in the GoToWebinar session. So very similar screen that we had before. You see the outline of where the recording session is going to be so that you can limit what is seen. If you see the gray box here in the middle, to move the entire box, you simply click in that gray box, and you can move the entire window around. I know that's different than our old solution, but you just have to click on that gray box and move it around. So I'm going to, there we go, move up here. I can change my size. I hit record, gives me a countdown, and we are now recording. Note that this, just like the prior implementation, does record audio as well. So you see the recording of the audio down here. You'll see the audio bar. You can turn that off, but it's actually, I think, a very good feature to have that audio since you can do narrations. We're going to hit done. We have the ability then, do you see the preview here? We can play back the preview, and then we can just upload it. We click upload. It'll transcode it. Takes a couple seconds here. Obviously, depends on how long the clip is to transcode that. Encodes it, uploads it. It'll take a second here. I love doing demos waiting for systems. There we go. Alrighty. And there we go. And now we've embedded that into the ticket, and off we go. The embedding that we do is a it's MPEG-4 encoded. If anybody really wants to geek out with me, and we're putting it in as an HTML5 video tag. So it's a little bit different of how it gets presented in the system. For browsers that don't, or web clients that don't support that, you will see instead of the graphic there, you will see a textual link that says, to see screen recording, please click here. And they simply click that, and they'll have the ability that will open up in a browser and play back for them. The only concern we haven't quite solved, and we're working very closely with our vendor on this, is we have, of course, many thousands of videos that are in our vendor system that we're trying to move over. They have promised us they're not going anywhere anytime soon, so it should still be available. And we are working with them to try to figure a transition plan to get those videos over. So at this point, we believe they'll be still accessible, and we're hoping to migrate them over to our storage here shortly, but that has not happened yet, and we're actively working with them on that. So headlines are new screen recorder, works very much the same as the old version, except it's ours and should actually work better. So again, I'll toss it back to Eric. Did I get everything covered there, Eric? Off mute.
Yeah, just to note, it's the same technology we have on the portal as well. So it's the
Thank you.
New button there too.
Yep, the portal has the same ability as the main application. So your customers can still submit tickets to you just like you can here. Alrighty. Next new feature. This one we're actually putting in public beta, but it's video recording. And again, something we're pretty excited about. We can now use a webcam or any camera attached to your computer and record video and audio directly into the ticket. And your customers can do this as well through the portal. So why would you want to do this? Well, really two different reasons. One is for a much more personal touch to a response. We have customers that have very high value clients who've actually in some cases segmented their client base out, and they will, for those high touch customers, they will actually do video responses for them just to give a personal touch. Instead of a textual response, it's a face and a name and a voice talking to them about the issue and thanking them for their business and talking to them about how to solve a particular problem. The other group of customers that are really excited about this are some of our customers that support physical products more so than pure software products. So as we have in the screen recording where you can have a software product and record the screencast, you can do the same thing with a video recording. You can take your webcam, you can point it at the physical piece of hardware that you're supporting and talk about how to solve the problem. You punch this button, then this button, this button, and it does this. And your customers can do the same thing. They can say, hey, we're trying to do this, and it doesn't work, and here's what we're doing. And actually shoot a video to send your support technicians of exactly what they're doing to replicate the problem. So the same idea that we have in video recording for your screen or screen recording, we can do in video recording as well. So we are calling this a public beta. It is brand new technology for us. We are actually using a particular technology called WebRTC. Again, not to geek out too much, I apologize, but it's pretty exciting technology, but it is not supported by all browsers yet. Specifically, Apple is not supporting it. They have a competing technology, their FaceTime technology, so they've not elected to support WebRTC. It is a Google initiative that's been adopted by many other browsers, so we'll see kind of how that falls out, but we believe that WebRTC is going to be the future of audio and video on the web, and again, we're pretty excited about it. The first place we're implementing this is going to be in the video recording in the ticket, but we may look to implement it in some other places as well. So this is going to be interesting. I'm not sure this is going to work. We may get a big delay, but we're going to try this anyway and see what happens. So to do a video recording, you click the video button up here, and hey, here we go. Where's my face? All right. So if you've ever wondered what I look like doing these webinars, what you see is me in my office looking out my computer, my webcam, and talking on my phone. The reason I use my phone is the audio is better than my computer audio, and it gives you guys a better experience. I'm not sure. I think there might be a significant audio delay here. You may see a little lip flap there, but you shouldn't see that when you do it for real. So when you're in a ticket, simply click the button right there. It says record video at the bottom of the action. You're going to get a video window, and you get two buttons right here. This is record. This is cancel. You click the record button, and now it starts recording. So now I am, it says in the top there, currently recording. I'm now recording this, waving hello to everybody. Thank you all for attending the webinar and watching me talk on the computer screen. And now we can hit stop. And you'll get the option to, the middle option here is insert or upload the video. This one is cancel. You upload it, and it takes a second or two to upload. And let's see if that's playable yet. There we go. So now you can see me and hear me on the video on TeamSupport within the action. So there we are. I look like a complete dork. I hate that. it's always embarrassing to see yourself on a screen. So that is, it uses your webcam. We're pretty excited about that feature. It is in public beta. In public beta, we've got another feature in public beta as well. But public beta means we really want you to test it out. We want you to play with it. We'd love to get feedback from you. Does it work? Does it not work? In cases where it doesn't work, we'd love to know how you got it to break. And also use cases. How are you using it? How do you see this as being beneficial to you? Do you see it being beneficial? And it'll also really help us with feature development on that feature and other features as well. So again, we're pretty excited about that one. So if you see, you may see some ticket responses from us to you guys when you submit tickets with our smiling faces in them in the near future as we play with our new feature as well. So last new feature, the new ticket page. We have been talking about the new ticket page for quite a while now. It has turned into a major engineering project. There was 5 years of code and history and architecture in the, we're calling now the classic ticket page, and to replicate all of that, expand on it, make it better, faster, etc., has been a significant engineering challenge, and I'll give kudos to our engineering team. They're doing a great job with it. So we've now, we've been using the new ticket page internally for a while. We've opened it up to a public beta, so it's optional, completely optional, if you choose to use it or not. So let me, without reading through this, I'll show you how you do that. First off, let me delete these images so they're never seen again.
Oh,
it's gone. You'll never see that one again. It's gone. So on your own instance of TeamSupport, you can, if you're an admin, you can do this to other people. If you're not an admin, you can do this to yourself. You go to the user setting, and down here on the second main section where it says use new ticket page in beta, you simply click that and change that from no to a yes, and now refresh your browser. You will see, next time you go to a ticket page, you will see,
drum roll,
presto, the new ticket page. There we go. So, very different look and feel of the ticket page. We've talked to a lot of our customers. We've got a lot of feedback. We've made a lot of changes on the ticket page. There are a lot of changes left to go. We really, really need your feedback on this. We have already, in fact, we turned it on over the weekend. We've got a lot of bug tickets already, which is great. That's why we opened this up. Some we knew about, some we didn't know about, but that's really the public beta is saying we think it's ready for you to take a look at. We don't think it's ready to, for prime time, so to speak. So please use this, please test it, please let us know what's broken, let us know what you like, let us know what you don't like. We really need to hear that feedback. So let me give you a little tour, what's new, what's different, what's changed. So one of the first things you'll notice, if you have tickets that span multiple days, is this cool timeline view. We've always had the date on the ticket, excuse me, always had the date on the action, but it wasn't always immediately apparent when an action had happened and what the time span difference was between the various items. Now we've got the timeline view. So you'll see tickets that are on the same day that all be in one grouping, and then you see a break, or sorry, actions in one day, and then you see a break in other actions. So it gives you a much better idea of how long the ticket has been open and how long that back and forth has been going on. Another thing is the public-private view has been changed. That's something that we had the eyeball on the old ticket page, and we got some complaints about that, that it wasn't as visible as we'd like to see. So we had added the ability to have a much more visible public or private view on a ticket. We also have the ability, if there's a water cooler ticket associated, sorry, water cooler conversation associated with the ticket, that is now embedded in the conversation or in the actions as well. So we're now taking public tickets, excuse me, public actions, private actions, and water cooler conversations and displaying it all in the same timeline view. Adding an action, similarly, we can add, there's simply buttons up here. We add a public action, private action, or water cooler. So I can add a private action to this ticket. It says it's private right there. I can't change it right now, so I can click on that and make it public. And we start typing away and adding an action to the ticket. Now, one of the neatest things, and we've already had a lot of conversation internal that we all love this feature, is you beforehand in the classic ticket page, when you add an action, you simply click save. And in most cases, when you click save, the next thing you did was you went up and changed the status of the ticket. So a lot of cases internally, we'll change it, we'll save an action, and then we'll set the status to waiting customer response or closed or something like that. So what we've done, which is a really neat feature, is instead of just hitting save, you can go to the right side here and you can save and set the status. So for example, the status right now says new. I can save the status to save and set status to pending customer reply. Saves me a click, status changes right there. So a neat feature, saves you a click, just makes it easier all the way around. The fields on the right-hand side are totally customizable. That was something else that we'd heard from a lot of people is the order of these fields, they need to be different. And everybody wants to use them differently. So on a per organization basis, we've made them totally customizable. And they're different for the ticket page and the new ticket page. You can set the order of the fields differently on those. Let's go create a new ticket here. So the new ticket page is also, similarly, it's changed quite a bit. Again, same functionality. The right-hand side here, again, we can change this all around. We can totally change how we do things on that ticket. So how we do that is we go to the admin page here, and we go to My Company, and we go to Ticket Page Order. And you'll see here that we have both the ticket page and the new ticket page. Now, this is global for an organization. We don't have the ability of doing this on an individual basis. It's on the organization basis. So we can change this order completely how you want to do it. We also can remove items. So we can get rid of items entirely if they're simply not used. There's no reason to have them on the either the new ticket page or the ticket page. You can simply remove them. We can also add a spacer or a line break. You'll see here we have an item with a line break. We can put as many of those in there as you want. And you'll see those are actually these guys right here, the line breaks. So those are allowing us to visually separate on the right-hand side the various groupings that you have in a system. In the current ticket page, we have very big blocks, but they're not movable. In this case, we wanted to add a line break, so you could separate those out. The other things, of course, we have the user's icons. So these are the internal icons for the agents and team support. If there are through customer insights, if we have information, we get a avatar of a customer, that will be in their action as well. So again, gives you more visual information. Instead of having to look at the person's name, you can immediately see their face or their avatar they've used. Internally, it's the same one we use in the water cooler. Externally, it's the ones we get from customer insights. There are a lot of changes on this page, a lot of different ways to do things. All of the functionality that we had in the old ticket page should be here. If it's not, let us know and we'll make sure to replicate that. We've already got, even after turning this on, just on Sunday, we've already seen a lot of feedback on this. But please give us feedback. I would love to hear it, good, bad, and different. Certainly need to hear that feedback. Again, Eric, I'm going to ask you the question. Is there anything you'd like to cover that I haven't touched on here?
Yeah, real quick, can you hover over the where the action number is, those three little dots there?
Good call. Thank you.
So here you got the ability to edit, delete, and of course those are admin settings. Pin an action, which is going to pin the action at the very top of the ticket every time. Put it in the knowledge base, and of course you can also toggle that visibility there, which that actually may go away since we can click the colors and do that. But just wanted to point out that you have those options there. And even though the numbers are a little bit out of order there, we did have a question come up about what the bold numbers were. They're supposed to be in order, but they're not, and that may be just a little bug that we're still sorting out. But that just simply gives you a way, if you're communicating with a coworker, not only can you say, you know, hey, pull up ticket 159 and see what's going on there, you can actually say pull up ticket 159 and look at action 3 and see what the customer had to say. So that's what that number represents.
Yeah, just to be clear, that actually is something in the current ticket page as well that exists already. And that's actually, you're right, this is actually an old bug. It's been fixed, but this ticket wasn't fixed when this ticket was created. That should be obviously 54321. So again, all the functionalities there, a bunch of new, you know, little pieces of functionality. Like, for example, I can say up here, I can say I don't want to see public and water cooler comments. I only want to see private comments. They show up here. So you can filter actually what you're seeing in the ticket page. A lot of little functionality changes, where we've tried to put the focus of the cursor, we try to place it where we think it's going to be used, and just a number of little, not always self-evident changes that we're trying to make this much smoother and much faster transaction for your agents as well. Certainly this is, if you look at our usage data and team support, the ticket pages, as you'd expect, are the one feature in the product that is used far and above more than anything else is in the system. So we are have spent a lot of engineering time making this better, making this faster as well. We're getting a lot faster load times, especially on very large tickets that have lots of actions, or very large actions. The load times are much more increased. Trying to make it visually look better, and also try to make it faster for your agents to use, less click heavy, trying to think ahead of what they may need to do. And again, those are areas where if you have ideas of how we can improve this even more, let us know. I can't guarantee they're going to make it into version 1, but if we don't know about it, we certainly can't, don't even have that option. So please give us that feedback. So with that, I will jump into Q&A time. This is as we usually done. I'll let Eric kind of moderate the questions. I see a number of questions have been asked during the session. What I will ask is, let's not talk about individual bugs or even feature requests in the ticket page particularly. If you have those, the best way to do those is to submit a ticket to us, and then that gets in our development queue, and you can also track if that's been addressed or not, you know, through our standard process. That's the best way you can do to help us by for all the new features we have in the system. If you have issues or suggestions, if you could throw those in as feature requests, we'd love, or as bugs or feature requests, we'd love to hear those. So with that being said, Eric, do you want to dive into some questions for us?
Yes, thanks, Robert. And a few of these I've just been building into the conversation that we've had, so I know everybody's busy, and again, we appreciate your time letting us go over this new stuff that we've got. A couple here. The old screen recording had a 5-minute duration limit, and wanted to know if that was if the same applied with this one, and that is true.
Yes, we still have a 5-minute limitation on there. Because we control the code base now, we didn't before, we certainly have more options there. And if there is a groundswell that people say we really need more, we can look into that. Our experience has been 5 has been a pretty good, and not really been a limiting factor. If it is, let us know. We'll look at it. No guarantees, but we have the option or the opportunity now to do a little more work there if we so choose.
And we've got one more. So if you have any questions and want to type them in, send them in. But the last one I've got here is talking about the ticket customization being made product line specific.
It's a good question. We've looked at it. We did actually talk about that internally. Right now, the answer is no. On any engineering project, we're looking to do something. We wanted to get it done and get it out, and we may look at that certainly in a version two of the feature. We didn't feel it was something we wanted to do on version one. We had enough work to do it in version one, and it was not, certainly it was expanded functionality. So perhaps not definitely, I think, is the answer there.
Okay. And a few people have actually asked about the video recording on the new ticket page, which we don't have in
there. Yeah. We noticed that this weekend as well. We don't have it there yet. It'll be there in 3 weeks. Our current release cycle, we are doing a bunch of cleanup on the current ticket page. No new functionality, all just bug cleanup. And again, thanks to a number of you who have submitted tickets to that already for us. So if you find, and so that release is going to go out, barring major QA issues, that should roll out this weekend. So the only changes there are going to be bug fixes and minor issues on the new ticket page. So if you do have issues there, let us know sooner rather than later, and we'll hopefully get that in this weekend's release. We're not going to add screen recording there. However, on this weekend's release, and our next release will be 2 weeks after that. We're not going to roll a release out over July 4th weekend. So we're hoping to get video recording into the release, which will be 3 weeks from now.
Very good.
Oh, great. Is that all we got?
Well, we've got, I want to throw one more in there.
Sure.
We actually had quite a few people throw in some questions in here, which would take us way beyond our time limit, so I apologize for that. But there's a question that's, I like to throw some unrelated ones in here sometimes. Any near-term plans to revise email notifications? And I'll actually just jump in really quick on that one, and Robert, you can follow me up. We would like some feedback on notifications from our customers. It's, to answer the specific question, near-term plans, no, but that's always up for discussion, and we've had some feedback over the years about different opinions on notifications, and not just email, but in-app and that sort of thing. So if you have ideas or suggestions on ways that we can enhance notifications of any kind, whether it be email or app or what have you, let us know what those are, because we're certainly always looking to make the experience more efficient for our customers.
Yeah, that's a great point, Eric. Thank you. It's notifications is one of those things that we've been talking about internally and in product development meetings for a very, very long time, and it doesn't seem like there is any perfect solution. Everyone wants it a little bit different, which is totally fine. And striking that balance is proven a little challenging. We have customers who tell us we have too much email, we have too little email, and then we have just the right amount of email. So the target is to provide settings and functionality in the system that gets us to the just the right amount, and make that adjustable for everybody as well. And that's work that's ongoing. We certainly have not perfected that yet, and we'll be certainly working on that in the coming future. Is that all good, Eric?
Yep, that
Eric,
thank you very much.
Did I lose you? There we go.
Yeah, that was it. Thank you, Robert. And there's a few more questions. I'm just afraid we're going to run out of time before we can get to all of them. So you get an answer. We got all these questions get logged, and we'll follow up with you this week on all of the questions that you have posed that we didn't get to address here on the call.
Excellent. Well, everybody, thank you very much. We always appreciate your attendance on these webinars. Of course, we will record it. I have been recording it, and we'll be sending it out to everybody. Thank you for using TeamSupport. Thanks for being a customer. Thanks for attending the webinar, and certainly, if you choose to, we certainly appreciate any feedback on the new features. We'd love to get feedback on that, and look forward to hearing from you. So for Eric and myself, and certainly the rest of the team behind TeamSupport, Thank you all very much. We really appreciate it, and have a great rest of your day.